Okay, Michael, so let's see if we can actually use this as a way of deriving something maybe that we already knew. So I'm going to go through a couple of these because I actually think, well, frankly, I just think it's kind of cool. But I'm hoping I can convince you it's sort of cool too and that we get something out of it. Okay, so let me set up the world. I'm going to set up a problem, and it's going to be a kind of generic problem. And I'm going to see what we can get out of it. Okay, so this is machine learning. So we're going to be given a bunch of data. So there are three assumptions that I'm going to make here. The first is that we're going to be given a bunch of label training data, which I'm writing here as x sub I and d sub I. So x sub I is whatever the input space is, and d sub I are these labels. And let's say it doesn't actually even matter what the labels are, but let's say that the labels are classification labels, okay? Hmm. All right. And furthermore, not only are we given this data as examples drawn from some underlying concept C, but they're in fact noise-free, okay? So they're true examples that tell you what C is, okay? So I'm going to say, in fact, let me write that down because I think it's important. They're noise-free examples. Okay?
Like di equals c of xi.
That's right, for all xi. So the second assumption is that the true concept c is actually in our hypothesis space, whatever that hypothesis space is. And finally, we have no reason to believe that any particular hypothesis in our hypothesis space is more likely than any other. And so we have a uniform prior over our hypotheses.
So it's like the one thing we know is that we don't know anything.
That's right. So sometimes people call this an uninformative prior because you don't know anything. Except, of course, I've always thought that's a terrible name because it's a completely informative prior. In fact, it's equally as informative as every other prior in that it tells you something, that all hypotheses are equally likely. But that's a...
I thought it was called an uninformed prior.
Is it? So it's just an ignorant prior is what you're telling me.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then maybe that's the problem. Maybe it's always had a problem with it because people keep calling it uninformative and they really mean uninformed. Okay. In any case, so these are our assumptions. We've got a bunch of data. It's noise-free. The concept is actually in the hypothesis space we care about, and we have a uniform prior. So we need to compute the best hypothesis. So given that, we want to somehow compute the probability of some hypothesis given the data, right? That's just Bayes' rule. So, Michael, you've got the problem, right?
Yes.
Okay. So in order to compute the probability of hypothesis given the data, we just need to figure out all of these other terms. So let me just write down some of the terms, and you could tell me what you think the answer is. Okay.
Yep. Well, what was the question?
The question is, well, we're going to want to compute some kind of expression for the probability of a hypothesis given the data. So given some particular hypothesis, I want to know what's the probability of that hypothesis given the data. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay, and you've got the setup. So we're going to compute that by figuring out these three terms over here. So let's just pick one of them to do. Let's try the prior probability. So, Michael, what's the prior probability on H?
Did we say that it was a finite hypothesis class?
It is a finite hypothesis class.
Then it's like 1 over the size of that hypothesis class because it's uniform.
That's exactly right. Uniform means exactly that. Okay, so we've got one of our terms. Good job. let's pick another term. How about the probability of data given a hypothesis? What's that?
The probability. So I guess noise free, and we know that it's noise free. So they're all going to be zeros and ones.
Mm-hmm.
So and it's going to be a question of whether or not the data is consistent with that hypothesis, right? If the labels all match.
Right.
What we'd expect them to be, if that really were the hypothesis, then we get a one. Otherwise, we get a zero.
That's exactly right. So let me see if I can write down what I think you just said. The probability of the data given the hypothesis is therefore 1 if it's the case that the labels and the hypothesis agree for every single one of the training examples, right?
Yep.
Is that what you said? Good. And if any of them disagree, then the probability is 0. So that's actually very important. It's important to understand exactly what it means to have the probability to give the hypothesis, as we mentioned before, that the English version of this is, what's the probability that I would see data with these labels in a universe where H is actually true? Which is different from saying that H is true or H is false. It's really a comment about the labels that you see on a data in a universe where H happens to be true.
Okay. But, you know, it's occurring to me now that you wrote that down that we've talked about this idea before.
When?
Well, so like there's a shorter way of writing that, which is D of H equals 1 if H is in the version space of D.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. So in fact, that will help us to compute the final term that we need, which is the probability of seeing the data labels. So how would we go about computing that? Well, it's exactly going to boil down to the version space, as you say. Let me just write out a couple of steps so that it's pretty kind of easy to see. It's sometimes easier in these situations to kind of break things up. So the probability of the data sort of formally is equal to just this. So we can write the probability of the data as being basically a marginalized version of the probability of the data given each of the hypotheses times the probability of the hypotheses. Now, this is only true in a world where our hypotheses are mutually exclusive, okay? So let's assume that we're in that world because, frankly, that's what we always assume. And this little trick is going to work out for us because we're going to get to take advantage of two terms that we've already computed, namely the probability of the data given the hypothesis and the probability prior probability of a particular hypothesis. So we know that the prior probability of a hypothesis is, right? It's just 1 over the size of the hypothesis space. And how am I going to substitute in this equation for the probability of the data given the hypothesis?
So I don't know. I would write that differently. I mean, it's basically it's like the indicator function on whether or not HI is in the version space of D.
Right. That's exactly right. So, in fact, this is not a good way to have written it. Let's see if I can come up with a good notational way of doing it. Let's say for every hypothesis that is in the version space of the hypothesis space, given the labels that we've got. Okay? How's that count?
Okay.
So rather than having to come up with an indicator function, I'm just going to define VS as the subset of all those hypotheses that are consistent with the data.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. And so what's the probability of those?
1.
It's 1, and it's 0 otherwise. So then we can simplify this sum, and it's simply what?
The sum of the 1 over... Oh! The 1 over H doesn't even depend on the hypothesis.
Mm-hmm.
I see. Wait, I don't see. Oh, yes, I do. It's 1 over the size of the version space. No, it's the size of the version space over the size of the hypothesis space.
That's exactly right. Basically, for every single hypothesis in the version space, we're going to add 1. And how many of those are there? Well, the size of the version space number of those, and multiply all that by 1 over the size of the hypothesis space, and so the probability of the data is that term. So now we can just substitute all of that into our handy-dandy equation up there, and let's just do that. So the probability of the hypothesis given the data is the probability of the data given the hypothesis, which we know is 1 for all those that are consistent, 0 otherwise. The probability of the prior probability over the hypothesis is just 1 over the size of the hypothesis space. And the probability of the data is the size of the version space over the size of the hypothesis space, which, when we divide everything out, is simply this. Got it?
Got it.
So what does that all say? It says that given a bunch of data, your probability of a particular hypothesis being correct or being the best one or the right one is simply uniform over all of the hypotheses that are in the version space. That is, are consistent with the data that we see.
Nice.
It is kind of nice. And by the way, if it's not consistent with it, then it's 0. So this is only true for hypotheses that are still in the version space and 0 otherwise. Now, notice that all of this sort of works out only in a world where you really do have noise-free examples and you know that the concept is actually in your hypothesis space and, just as crucially, that you have a uniform prior over all the hypotheses. Now, this is exactly the algorithm that we talked about before, right? We talked about before what would we do to kind of decide whether a hypothesis was good enough in this sort of noise-free world. And the answer we came up with is you should just pick one of them that's in the version space. And what this says is there's no reason to pick one over the other from the version space. They're all equally as good, or rather equally as likely to be correct.
Yeah, that follows.
Yeah, so there you go. So it turns out you can actually do something with this. Notice, by the way, that we didn't pick a particular hypothesis space. We didn't pick a particular form of our instance space. We didn't say actually anything at all about exactly what the labels were, other than that they were labels of some sort. And the strongest assumption that we made was a uniform prior. So this is always the right thing to do, at least in a Bayesian sense, in a world where you've got noise-free data, you have a finite hypothesis space, and you have uniform priors. Just pick something from the consistent set of hypotheses.